Hi, my name is Dr. Stephen Flamm. I'm the medical director of liver transplantation and a professor of medicine at the Northwestern University Feinberg School of Medicine. I'm sure this is a very, very nervous day for many of you when we start the orientation and education process for liver transplantation. As a patient with chronic liver disease, family members, caregivers of patients with chronic liver disease, it's a very, very difficult time. But fortunately, life-saving liver transplantation is available to many. Part of the process, though, is to be fully oriented and educated about the liver transplantation process. Today, in the next 45 minutes or so, I'm going to discuss with you a little bit about the background of chronic liver disease. We're going to talk about the liver transplantation process. We'll talk about the evaluation, how one is placed on the waiting list and how they're informed, how livers are allocated once you're on the liver transplantation list, responsibility that the patients have and their family and caregivers to remain on the liver transplantation list, and a little bit about the post-liver transplantation experience. Now again, we can't go through the entire process in 45 minutes. And I hope that you have a pen or pencil and paper and that you will be able to jot down some questions you might have about my presentation. Because when you come into the office and meet us in person, you will be afforded a lot of time to ask any questions that you have so that you can be fully apprised of what's going to happen. I hope everybody does well and has the best of luck. So with that, we'll begin to discuss the Transplantation Orientation and Education Day, which we call the TOED Clinic. What you need to know about liver transplantation. First, liver disease and transplantation. What does your liver do? The liver lies underneath your rib cage on the right upper side of your abdomen. It weighs about 3 pounds. You don't have to be a healthcare provider to know that the liver is vital and that without a liver, you can't survive. It has many very important, critical functions that allow survival. Some, but not all, include bile that's produced by the liver. Bile is a substance that helps in the digestion and absorption of food. The liver is a very important organ for filtering blood and removing toxins and chemicals. The liver also metabolizes medications, drugs that we take. Also, the liver makes very important proteins, proteins that are important for life. Some of these proteins are helpful for blood clotting, and others carry out vital functions as they circulate in your bloodstream, carrying other chemicals around. So the liver has many, many vital functions, and without it, patients are very sick, as many of you know, and you can't, in the end, survive. This is what a healthy liver looks like. Now, when the liver is analyzed by the healthcare providers who take care of patients like you or your family members, we look at a liver and we split it into two lobes. The liver is split into two parts. One is the right lobe, which is the larger half. So it's not the larger half, but the larger part. And the left lobe is the smaller part. And it's not so much important for medical doctors like me, but it's very important for the surgeons who cut the liver and remove it so that they know all the anatomy of the liver to be able to carry out the surgical procedures appropriately. Now, you don't have to be a doctor to recognize that a cirrhotic liver is not normal. And there's a picture of it here on this slide. Now, cirrhosis means your liver, for any of a number of reasons, has been damaged, usually over many, many, many years, 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years. And because of that damage, scar tissue forms in the liver. And it increases over all those years to the point that the liver can't function anymore. A liver that is cirrhotic, which means it has a very great amount of scarring in it, looks abnormal. It looks abnormal to the naked eye. You don't need to look under a microscope to see that it's abnormal. And it looks like the picture on this slide. Now, just because you have cirrhosis doesn't mean you're going to die soon. It's a misconception for many patients. They hear the word cirrhosis and they think the end is near. Excuse me. It may in fact be near. And I'll tell you how we as healthcare providers for patients with liver disease know when to be really worried about you. But some patients with cirrhosis can do fine for years and years and years. We use the term compensated cirrhosis to mean a patient has cirrhosis, and yet their short-term mortality, meaning the chance that they're going to die in the short term, is actually not very high. On the other hand, patients with decompensated liver disease, with certain problems having developed, those are patients that do have very high short-term mortality, meaning that in the very near future, their chance of dying is great. Those are the patients that we consider for life-saving liver transplantation. Compensated cirrhosis patients have no complications, which I'm going to discuss with you in a moment. They have preserved liver function on paper. Their protein levels are still excellent, despite the fact that the liver has damage. And this slide says the average life expectancy is 12 years. But in fact, if people have a compensated liver with cirrhosis, and if you remove the cause of the cirrhosis, if you treat the underlying disease process, in 10 years, 90% are still alive. On the other hand, the patients with decompensated cirrhosis, they do have at least one complication. Again, I'm going to discuss some of them in a minute. They often, if not always, have dysfunction of the liver. When you look at the blood tests, the protein levels are no longer normal. And those patients have an average life expectancy of about 2 years. Again, those are the patients that we consider for liver transplantation. There are many complications of cirrhosis. Patients that are watching this know about some of these complications. That's why you're watching this. But I'm going to mention some of these common ones. One is ascites. Ascites is the medical word for water in the belly. It's not really water, but it's similar to that. It's a liquid. And there's a picture of somebody with severe ascites on this slide. Many patients don't have ascites to this degree, but when you have water in the belly as a result of cirrhosis, that's a bad sign. Furthermore, the water can get infected, and if an infection comes in that water, we call it spontaneous bacterial peritonitis, SBP, and that infection has to be treated very quickly and effectively because it has a high mortality. Patients can also have what we call varices. These are like varicose veins. But here, these large veins are in your esophagus or your stomach. You can't feel them. And yet, the first time you might know they're there, other than a doctor telling you who is looking for them, is when they rupture and bleed. And of course, that is a life-threatening complication. And another one that we as healthcare providers who take care of liver patients worry about. And a third one that is very problematic for patients and their family members and caregivers is called hepatic encephalopathy. This is where the mentation, your ability to think well, is affected. I mentioned to you already that one of the jobs of the liver is to clear toxins from the blood. If the liver is very sick, toxins can escape. They can stay in your bloodstream and later go to your brain and affect the way you think. Now, the toxin levels can rise and fall, so the problems with thinking can come and go. They can be very subtle, where patients have what we call sleep-wake reversal. They're more tired during the day and wide awake at night. And the symptoms can worsen. You can have personality changes. You can have slurred speech. You can have disorientation. You can have confusion. You can even become so affected by this that patients can go into a coma. Again, once the toxins are removed, your thinking goes back to normal. But of course, this is very problematic because people with this problem often can't drive or they have trouble working. Again, hepatic encephalopathy. If a patient has any one of these problems, and there are a few others that are less common, in the setting of cirrhosis, we worry about you because this means, again, that you have decompensated cirrhosis, and it means your chance of dying of chronic liver disease is very high in the near future. And this should prompt referral to a center like Northwestern for transplantation evaluation. Now, there are many, many diseases of the liver that can damage the liver so that in the end, transplantation is considered. And many are listed on this slide. Lay people often think the only reason to have a liver problem like cirrhosis is from drinking alcohol. Certainly, drinking alcohol can cause cirrhosis, and many patients have alcoholic liver disease. But there are many, many, many other reasons unrelated to alcohol use that also cause the same liver damage, the same cirrhosis that alcohol causes, and in the end, cause those same complications and also require liver transplantation in order to optimize the chance that someone can survive for a long time. Now, on this slide, I underlined some of the more common causes of cirrhosis and the need for liver transplantation. One of the most common causes now is a disease called fatty liver or non-alcoholic steatohepatitis or NASH. That is a disease of greatly increased frequency in the United States and all over the world. And we expect in the field of hepatology that disease to increase dramatically, more so in the coming years. You also see on this slide hepatitis B, hepatitis C, primary biliary cholangitis, primary sclerosing cholangitis. These are all other common causes of advanced liver disease and the need for liver transplantation. On this slide are some additional reasons that we consider liver transplant. And I particularly want to focus on the row that talks about malignancy liver tumors. Hepatocellular carcinoma, which is the medical word for liver cancer, is a very common problem once somebody has cirrhosis. And I'm going to mention that a little bit more in detail in a few minutes. And if you catch liver cancer early, you can be cured by liver transplantation. And that is a reason that many of you have been referred to Northwestern for liver transplantation evaluation. The waste pipes of the liver being a factory, the waste pipes of the liver are called bile tubes. They're connected, of course. They take the waste from the liver, the factory, and dump it into your gut. And then later you excrete the waste in the stool. The bile tubes can also have liver problems, including cancer. That is not called liver cancer. That's called bile duct cancer or cholangiocarcinoma. And that's another reason that patients might require evaluation for liver transplantation. I told you I talked briefly about hepatocellular carcinoma or liver cancer. Cirrhosis itself, no matter what the cause, is in many patients a pre-cancerous condition. It is the standard of care in every patient with cirrhosis, no matter how well you feel, even the patients with the compensated cirrhosis. And those patients often have no symptoms at all. they are still at increased risk for liver cancer, and those patients should undergo liver cancer screening with a picture of the liver, an imaging, an ultrasound, or a CAT scan, or an MRI every 6 months. And the reason is patients with cirrhosis are at increased risk. And again, if you catch it when it's early, when it's very small, the cancer, you are a candidate to have that cancer removed, usually by transplant, where you remove not only the cancer, but the entire liver with it. Now, sometimes patients say, why do I need to look? I don't feel anything. The whole point is, really with any cancer, but liver cancer, because that's what we're talking about here, to find it before you have any symptoms. If you wait until there are symptoms to find it, it's often too late. So you must do this liver cancer screening, and some of you, again, have already had cancer identified. It turns out that we think up to one-third of patients with cirrhosis will in their lifetime develop liver cancer, again called hepatocellular carcinoma. I talked to you a little bit about the complications of cirrhosis already. Fatigue and muscle wasting, they're not a complication which specifically indicate a poor survival in the near future, but it's very problematic for patients because they're very tired and they become very weak because the muscle breaks down when your liver is very sick. And you start to get weak shoulders and weak thighs and your arms get small. And you can start to see sometimes muscle wasting in your temples, up in your face. And people can start to notice that you don't look as well. We talked about hepatic encephalopathy already. We talked about ascites, which is water in the belly. You can also have water around your lung from the liver, usually on the right side. We call that hepatic hydrothorax. Some people get kidney problems when they have cirrhosis for reasons that aren't really completely clear. The kidneys are very vulnerable when you have cirrhosis, particularly if the cirrhosis is very severe. And patients can have kidney failure too and require special medications. And sometimes in the end, they need not only a liver transplant, but they need a kidney transplant with it. When patients have a sick liver with cirrhosis, with scarring in the liver, the blood flow in the belly to the liver is held up a little bit because of the abnormal liver that you saw a picture of earlier. So you get very high blood pressure inside your belly, not in your arm when the doctor takes the blood pressure or the nurse, but in the belly. We call that portal hypertension, and that is the cause, actually, of many of those complications that I told you about earlier. And then some patients get jaundice, where their eyes start to turn yellow. That's a sign that your liver isn't functioning well, because a normal functioning liver gets rid of the pigment that causes those yellow eyes normally. And if the liver is very dysfunctional, the pigment accumulates in the blood because the liver can't get rid of it, and you can see it in the eyes. You also can have dark urine too. The urine can be tea-colored in patients that have yellow eyes or jaundice. And then we, as healthcare providers who take care of liver patients, also look at the blood test. Because again, the liver's a factory. It makes proteins. The proteins are clotting factors. There's a protein called albumin that's very important. We look at all of these every time we get your blood test because we get a sense of how well the liver is doing, how the factory is working by analyzing these blood tests. And I talked to you about the veins that you can also have that are really big and juicy and can rupture if they're present in the esophagus and in the stomach. Now, when your liver is failing, when you develop any of those complications, we try, of course, to manage you with medical therapy. And that might include medications. It might include lifestyle changes for you that we recommend. It might include procedures by doing, for instance, an endoscopy to reassess those varices. Or some patients need what we call a paracentesis, where patients have to have water removed from their belly with a needle by the radiology doctors. We try medical management. Now, if medical management is ineffective, if these complications persist, it's a sign that the liver is failing and is not responding to the medical management, and we need to contemplate liver transplantation. Now, the standard way of liver transplant has always been a deceased donor liver transplant. A donor passes away for some reason, and the family opts to donate their organs, one of which is a liver. But at Northwestern, for about 20 years or so, in adult recipients, adult patients with chronic liver disease, we have also been performing living liver donation liver transplants, where somebody who's alive can donate a portion of their liver to you. And believe it or not, because a normal liver regenerates, the liver in the donor regenerates, the liver in you, the recipient, regenerates. And in the end, you have two normal or nearly normal sized livers within a very short period of time. So that is what we, one of the things we do offer here at Northwestern for appropriate patients, living liver donor transplantation. What are the benefits of liver transplantation if medical therapy fails and if a patient is a donor and is fortunate enough to get a liver transplant? First of all, it clearly improves quality of life. It certainly lengthens life expectancy. There is no time span, no expiration date on a liver. If all goes well after liver transplantations, livers can last indefinitely. Livers are, for instance, given to children. We don't do that at Northwestern Memorial with the adults. I'm not a pediatrician. We do pediatric liver transplantation at Children's Hospital here. But when you do give a liver transplant to a baby that might be born with a congenital problem, the liver lasts indefinitely. And the same is true with an adult. The decision to undergo liver transplantation evaluation and subsequently a liver transplant, though, is always the patient's. It's not ours. You are the boss of what happens to you if you're one of the patients watching this video. And if you choose not to do it, we don't do it. We take care of you still, but we don't force patients to undergo liver transplant evaluation or undergo liver transplantation. We make recommendations and you make the decision. Everybody's not a liver transplantation candidate. There are many, many reasons why you may not be a liver transplantation candidate, and we do that evaluation. Liver transplantation is a very involved process. It is time consuming. It requires a lot of testing. And some patients we know aren't going to do well after liver transplantation, and therefore we might not recommend it in you. For instance, we evaluate other medical issues. Some patients have many other complicated medical problems that can impact on their ability to get through a transplant operation. A patient must be strong enough to tolerate the surgery and recover from the surgery. You have to be able to walk after surgery. The term we use is ambulate, because patients that are stuck in bed for long periods of time after the surgery don't do very well. We look at psychosocial issues. We do a full psychosocial evaluation of every patient that is undergoing liver transplant evaluations. For instance, does a patient adhere to medical recommendations? Are there drug and alcohol issues which might impact on the ability of a patient to take medications properly, adhere to visits, and for the organ, if we do a liver transplant, to thrive? Does a patient have appropriate family and caregiver support? You need to have support to come to office visits before a transplant, and then to have somebody help take care of you while you're recovering from the liver transplantation surgery. And what about insurance? Patients must have some coverage, not only for the procedure, but for the medications before and after liver transplantation. And again, we have social workers, and if necessary, psychologists or psychiatrists that evaluate patients who are undergoing liver transplantation evaluation. And what about the liver transplantation evaluation? There's a big team. I'm one of the hepatologists and, again, the medical director. There are many others here at Northwestern that might see you. There are the transplant surgeons that actually do the surgery and manage patients very carefully right after their transplant operation. There are outstanding transplantation nurse coordinators that are really the keys to helping you get through the liver transplantation process before the transplant, and there are nurse coordinators after transplant that are different in the liver in the liver program that help you after transplant. There are medical assistants, pharmacists, the social workers and psychiatrists that I already mentioned to you. We have dietitians as part of our team. We do clinical research that's appropriate and often helpful for some patients with various different problems awaiting liver transplantation. We have physical therapists to help you get stronger before and after liver transplantation. We have financial liaisons that can help with some of the financial issues. And then some patients, depending on their current state and other medical problems, require other consultants. And we would make arrangements for you or help you make arrangements to see them if necessary. What does transplantation evaluation require? You have to see a surgeon. You have to see one of the hepatologists like me. You have to see the social worker and many patients, the transplant team psychiatrist. There's a mandatory nutrition evaluation and a mandatory physical therapy evaluation. We do blood work on your first visit and every visit thereafter. We do liver imaging, as I said, because patients with cirrhosis are at increased risk for liver cancer. Patients must undergo cardiac evaluation if liver transplantation moves forward, and that includes some cardiac testing and evaluation by one of the cardiologists here that is aware of the transplantation process and can approve you for the transplantation surgery. Patients also get pulmonary testing, and if there are lung issues, they might need to see one of the pulmonary doctors or the lung doctors in as well. Some patients have had infections in the past, and that sometimes can be problematic after liver transplantation when we use immunosuppressive therapy. So we might have to consult an infectious diseases doctor. Cancer screening. We don't want to do a liver transplant and give patients immune suppression medicines after, which I'm going to talk about in a few minutes. If you have a cancer, because it can make a cancer that you have somewhere else worse. So women get mammograms for breast cancer. We make sure appropriate people have had colonoscopy to look for colon cancer. Older men, we make sure that prostate cancer has been evaluated. And on and on. We make sure before liver transplantation that, to the best of our ability, that patients don't have a cancer. And there may be additional testing as we deem necessary. There are transplant education sessions, one of which is this, but the liver transplant nurse coordinators provide an education session for you regarding the transplantation process, placement on the wait list, rules, regulations, and qualifications, not only for patients, but for family members and caregivers. Many of which I'm going to touch on today, but there are some nursing-related aspects, some of the practical parts of the process that patients and their families want to know, and the nurses actually handle those. Now, some patients, I mentioned living liver donation, liver transplant. We have a special nurse coordinator that talks about that, if that's an option for certain patients. And there's a separate education process for some of the patients that talk about that process. And then the liver transplant surgeons also provide an additional session regarding living liver donation from the surgical standpoint. And they talk about the types of liver organ offers that you might receive. And I want to highlight two special programs that we have here at Northwestern, which I think are unique. First, we have the Hispanic Liver Transplantation Program. The Hispanic population has one of the fastest growth rates in the United States and represents now the largest minority group in the United States. In the Chicago area alone, we estimate that there are about 800,000 Hispanic people. And in the greater Chicago area, as many as 2 million. The majority of these patients speak Spanish, a quarter speak English, and Unfortunately, in the Hispanic population, there is a high incidence and prevalence of diseases leading to cirrhosis and liver failure, and that require liver transplantation evaluation. I have Dr. Caicedo's picture here. He's currently the liver transplantation surgical director. He speaks Spanish, and he runs this Hispanic liver transplant program. So in an effort to meet the need of this growing population in the Chicagoland area, Northwestern Medicine has a comprehensive, culturally sensitive Hispanic transplant program with bilingual team members and a dedicated transplantation clinic for them. We have a Spanish phone line for patients, for referring physicians, for clinical staff and case managers, and more than 40 Spanish-speaking staff, again, including surgeons, the medical liver doctors, social worker, transplant nurse coordinator, financial coordinator, and other support staff. It's culturally sensitive, coordinated care. We have Spanish patient education materials and access to clinical research. And I don't have a slide on it, but I also want to highlight another unique program here at Northwestern, our African American transplantation program. We also have a very culturally sensitive, coordinated care dedicated to African Americans. And Dr. Simpson's the lead. And that also may be something that you, patients, or family members and caregivers wish to avail yourself of. Now, what about the wait list, the liver transplantation wait list? This is a common question for people that are entering the process. Once the patient has completed all of the required testing and blood work, I mentioned to you before, there are blood tests we do, and then patients have to have a cardiac and pulmonary evaluation and may need to see special consultants depending on their certain circumstances. Once that's done, the patient is fully discussed at our multidisciplinary transplantation committee. We have a committee with all the members of the team, and that committee discusses all aspects of the patient to determine if liver transplantation is a wise idea for that particular patient. And if so, the patient is approved for listing. The patient is placed on the waiting list. The waiting list in the United States, everywhere in the United States, as a matter of fact, is governed by the United Network for Organ Sharing called UNOS. So you're put on the UNOS list. The transplant team will notify the patient of the committee's decision, and the patient will also receive written confirmation in the mail confirming placement on the liver transplantation waiting list. On the wait list, a patient must adhere to all the follow-up appointments, recommended testing, and procedures. Adherence is considered a vital assessment for candidacy for a liver transplant. Not only before you're put on the list, but while you're on the list. And if a patient does not comply with the transplant team recommendations, they are re-presented to the multidisciplinary transplant committee meeting to reassess candidacy for liver transplant. And the committee then decides if the patient remains on or is removed from the wait list. And by the way, you can be listed at other transplantation centers at the same time if you wish, although the workup is usually done all over again at other centers. While you're on the wait list, you must remain abstinent from alcohol or other substances. And furthermore, even after liver transplantation, you must remain abstinent. Patients must remain compliant with all social worker psychiatric recommendations. If there are substance abuse issues in the past, including drugs or alcohol, the social workers and the psychiatry providers will recommend counseling. It could be individual or group. They may recommend inpatient or outpatient rehab. They may recommend participation in Alcoholics Anonymous, AA. They may recommend other testing to be done, like alcohol and toxicology screening randomly. You may get called at a certain time and have to go within a certain number of hours to get testing. And if you don't, that's considered a fail. So if you wonder, why do they do this? It's not punitive. Patients that are drinking alcohol or using drugs while they're on the wait list or after transplantation tend not to do very well. The social workers, the psychiatrists, they're professionals. They know it's what they do, what is most likely for a patient with certain kinds of problems to do well after transplant and over the long term, and they make recommendations to that end. So patients have to do them. You don't have to do them, but then you don't get a liver transplant if you don't want to adhere to the recommendations. Again, if not compliant, patient is represented to the multidisciplinary committee for a candidacy discussion, and removal from the wait list is a possibility. Now, how do you get a liver when you're on the wait list? The basis for the regular non-living liver donation, liver transplant, organ allocation, when you're allocated a liver the regular way, we use a score that's calculated from blood tests called the MELD score. And MELD stands for Model for End-Stage Liver Disease. You see MELD score in the middle of this slide. It is a score that highest score is 40. The lowest score you can have is 6. Livers are allocated to patients on a transplant list in a particular area based completely on that MELD score. And the MELD score is calculated by putting the blood tests that are shown below on this slide into a formula. It's a very complicated formula, but you can Google it. If you have these blood tests of your own at your hand, creatinine is a kidney test. The INR are the clotting factors I mentioned to you that the liver makes. The bilirubin is the pigment that causes the yellow. And then the sodium is an electrolyte in the blood. If you have those numbers in front of you and you Google MELD score, you can put those four numbers into the formula and hit enter, and the MELD score will come up. That's what the nurses do, the nurse coordinators. And you'll see what it is. The higher you are, the more priority you have for getting a liver. The lower you are, the lower priority you are. And it changes. Every time we do blood tests, we recalculate the MELD score, and your priority can change. If your MELD score gets higher, you're higher up on the list. And if your MELD score goes lower, you're lower on the list. That's how it happens. It's on a computer. The doctors don't make a decision. We don't say we like one person more than another. You get a liver completely 100% based on that MELD score. It's a completely objective assessment. Now, there are a few liver conditions that patients can qualify for a higher MELD score than the real MELD score. And for these conditions, we have to submit a request to a special review board under the umbrella of the United Network for Organ Sharing, UNOS, which governs this list. And for instance, one is liver cancer, one is cholangiocarcinoma, the cancer of the bile tubes, one is a liver-lung syndrome called hepatopulmonary syndrome, there's another liver-lung syndrome called portopulmonary hypertension. Some patients get infections from their bile tubes if they have certain medical problems from the liver, which we call infectious cholangitis, and those patients may be eligible. And then there are other rare liver diseases that we can seek to have a higher MELD score assigned to you than what the blood tests otherwise show. And again, all of this you will be informed about when we see you. When you're put on the list, there are a couple of things that are important for the surgeons, who are the ones that get the calls about a liver when a liver is offered, for you. One is the size, of course. We look at the general size of a patient. If a donor has a very tiny liver and you're a very big guy, that won't work. And similarly, if you're a very little person and a gigantic liver gets offered, that also won't work. So size is one important thing. And the second very important thing is blood type. Blood types have to match in a way that there isn't a bad interaction. So the doctors will, on the first visit, check your blood type. And when you do a transplanted liver into a recipient, the blood type must be compatible, and the way it's listed here on this slide shows you how we match blood types so that there isn't a negative event. I mentioned a little before about that there are different types of donor organs, and a little more about how livers are allocated. Types of donor liver organs are here. There's donation after a brain death for a donor. There's donation after cardiac death. Some patients may, donors may have hepatitis C or may have had in the past hepatitis B, although they don't have it anymore. These are all factors that the team considers before they offer you a liver, and they tell you what kind of an organ donor is being offered to you. And in the end, you have to accept it. There's another thing called a split liver. I mentioned to you we have Children's Hospital here. This is also our program at Northwestern. If an infant gets an adult liver, then what happens is a little part of the adult liver is taken for the infant, and the rest of the adult liver, which is excellent, is still available. And that can be given to an adult. We call that a split liver. And again, that could be offered to you. And I told you about living liver donors. Obviously, you know about that because a person would be offering part of their liver to you, and that would be scheduled ahead of time. How livers are now distributed is new through the new organ distribution system called the concentric circle model. And the way it works is they look at where a donor liver is, where the person is who's donating liver, and they draw circles of different miles around that hospital until they hit a transplant center, or two or three or four. And then they offer the liver within that distance circle to the person on the list that has the highest MELD score. And that's how it's done now. The organ offer. The phone call to the patient with the liver offer happens after the transplant surgeons, of course, receive the initial call that there's a potential donor for you. And then the patient, by the way, ahead of time, you are told that you're high up on the transplant list by the nurse coordinators. They tell you ahead of time, if they can, that you're high on the list. It's usually not a surprise that a call might be forthcoming. So it's a surprise the second it comes, but not in general that the call is coming. And once the surgeon gets a call about an appropriate donor that's assigned to you, the transplant nurse coordinator calls you and talks about the liver offer. The surgeons, meanwhile, are reviewing the donor's medical records and decide whether or not it sounds like a good organ for you. The nurse coordinator, when they call you the patient, they notify you if you're the primary person, meaning you're the person that the liver's assigned, or a backup. Sometimes there is somebody else ahead of you on the list that the liver is assigned, but they may be so ill or something might happen at the last minute that that person can't get the liver, and then you are second in line. And if that's true, you have to be ready to go. They can't wait a few hours with a liver, find out a first patient is not a good candidate for some reason, and then call you up and have you drive in 3 hours later. You have to be ready to go. And therefore, you may be a backup and be in the hospital waiting because the nurse coordinator asks you to come in. The nurse coordinator educates you and discusses with the patient and the family what type of liver the offer is, and then ultimately you make the decision. And if you're wondering, donors are not just accepted without testing. Donors go through an excruciatingly careful review of their medical history, discussion with the caring team, and then blood testing to rule out to the best that we can any problems that they might have that could be conferred to you, like any infections. But all risk, 100%, cannot be eliminated. Once you accept a liver offer, you are given instructions of when and where to come, when to come to the hospital, which is usually at that time, and where to go. You are not to eat or drink prior to possible surgery, and it is very advisable to bring with you a medication list or If you don't have time to make a list, if you haven't made one already, bring all the bottles with you to the hospital so that we can make an assessment of medicines that you have been taking up until the very time that you have surgery. Now, the surgical team, when you're coming in, by the way, is going out to the hospital where the donor is, and they evaluate the liver offer at the hospital where the donor is. Sometimes the liver, when the surgical team gets there, it doesn't look good. There's no way to know that ahead of time. And the surgical team goes all the way there, and they find that the liver is not acceptable, and they, in the end, don't accept it. You would then be informed, and you would be at the hospital already waiting, that the liver was not acceptable, and that you would be then discharged from the hospital. And if you're concerned, do you forfeit your spot in line? You don't. Your MELD score for liver allocation stays where it was, and you are in the same exact spot in line that you were to begin with. Now, if the donor liver is acceptable, the surgical team gets the liver, we use the term procures it, they bring it back to Northwestern urgently, and then you go to the operating room and the transplant surgery is started. Now, the length of the surgery, we get that question a lot too. It's variable. It can be 5 hours. It can be as long as 12 hours. A lot of it depends on surgery that you might have had previously, that a patient may have had, how severe the illness is before the transplant, what the illness of the transplant is, other medical problems that a patient might have, or any complications during the surgery that are unpredicted. After transplantation, you go first to intensive care. You then leave intensive care and go to the transplant floor. It is a dedicated floor for people that have had a liver transplant, so the nurses are very highly skilled. You end up being discharged, and then clinic follow-up will be arranged for you then. The time frame for recovery and hospital stay varies. It's usually at Northwestern, and this is different for everybody, in the 5 to 6 day range. And it depends on things again, like how ill you were prior to transplant, how, if you're walking, if you're ambulatory, if you had surgery before, how frail you were, and then other medical and surgical factors that are different for every single person. Now, in the post-surgical setting, those of you who have had surgery before, this, a lot of this is standard for any kind of surgery, especially when the abdomen's involved. There's a tube in your nose that helps deliver medications when you can't eat and you don't eat, but as you recover, your oral intake is advanced, first with clear liquids and then advancing the diet as well as you tolerate it. There are tubes that take fluid out of the stomach, which we call Jackson-Pratt tubes. There are tubes that help with urination. Physical therapy is arranged. The staples are eventually removed from the incision. You get very clear medication education for what to do and how to do it. And then again, you get whatever blood work tests and procedures you do, as well as clinic follow-up appointments arranged by the team once you're discharged. There are risks after transplantation. Transplantation is not a perfect process, but we don't do transplantation in healthy people. We do it in sick people. I told you earlier, we do it in people with decompensated cirrhosis, in patients in whom the 2-year survival is less than 50-50 without transplantation. So when you look at the potential benefit from transplant versus the risk of a transplant, the favor is way it's way in favor of the benefit of transplant than the risk. But for completeness, I want to mention some of the things that can happen. There, of course, are blood loss during surgery. People need transfusions. When you get transfusions, there are some risks to have transfusion reactions. There's pain afterwards, of course. There was a surgery. Some patients for a short period can have some nausea and vomiting. We look at, the surgeons look at the wound after surgery to make sure there isn't an infection. Blood clots are very uncommon but can occur. The heart has already been cleared before transplant, but we always follow cardiac issues after surgery. And then the very rare patient can have organ failure after a big surgery like this and even death. Very uncommonly, the organ can fail. There are a small number of patients that require another transplant after the first. Again, a small number, but it's not unheard of. Rejection. You do have rejection, just rejection of any organ after you do a transplant of any of the organs. It turns out, at least in acute rejection for liver disease, most of this is picked up just by abnormal blood tests, the medications are adjusted, and the rejection disappears. But we always monitor for rejection, and it is a possibility. And then there's another entity called chronic rejection or ductopenic rejection that can happen even years later. Again, very uncommon, but it does happen, and it can lead to recurrence of liver disease. And then people can have recurrence of their initial liver disease. For instance, if patients have fatty liver and they still have the risk factors for fatty liver, they can get fatty liver in the new liver. If patients have viral hepatitis, like hepatitis C, and it's not treated, which it always is, but if it weren't, you can get hepatitis C in the new liver. If people start drinking again, they can get alcoholic liver disease in the new liver. The new liver is not impervious to damage. So we, as part of the team, watch post-transplantation patients very carefully because we want you to live. We want you to hopefully live a long time and be very healthy so that you can enjoy life, enjoy, and enjoy your family. Donor-related risks. Again, these are not common either, but there are risks from the donor coming to you. I mentioned to you, we look very carefully for infections. Infections from a donor are exceedingly uncommon because we look for them so carefully. But again, you can never have a 100% clearance. Malignancies, we do a very careful evaluation of the donor, too, in terms of their medical history. And if they have active cancer, for instance, those are organs we don't take. But very rarely a patient might have a cancer we're unaware of, and they're unaware of, or their family is unaware of. So that's a potential risk. And then there's some risk for you, the patient, as a recipient from a psychological standpoint. Even though some patients, the vast majority of patients do fabulously well after liver transplantation, some patients have post-surgical depression. Some have post-surgical adjustment problems. Some have anxiety. Some feel guilty because they received a donor organ from somebody who passed away. Some have body image adjustment issues because of the scar, the incision. There's family issues, of course, stress, coping. There's recovery issues where you rely on someone for help even after liver transplant. So all of these are potential risks that we try to help you with in the post-transplant setting if they occur. And I told you a little bit ago about the medicines, immunosuppression medicines. Immunosuppression medicines are given at higher doses at the beginning and much lesser doses as time goes on. There, again, are special medical surgical teams that take care of after liver transplant patients. They're often different than the people who take care of you before.